Well, pharmacists in New South Wales will soon be allowed to prescribe hundreds of medications like antibiotics and the contraceptive pill in a bid to battle the state's GP shortage. But doctors aren't happy with the plan. The Royal Australian College of General Practitioners said their move was madness and a recipe for disaster.
For more, we're joined by New South Wales Health Minister Brad Hazzard in Sydney and President of the Pharmacy Guild New South Wales David Heffernan in the studio. Morning, guys. Nice to see you. Minister, a recipe that is built for disaster. I mean, how do you respond to that?
Well, obviously it's not. It works in New Zealand, in the UK, in Canada. But look, I think what we have seen over the period of particularly COVID is that pharmacists can step up and fill the gap. It's unfortunately now necessary because we're getting so few people coming out as GPs from medical school. And on top of that, in some areas in the rural areas, there are no GPs at all, but there are pharmacists. Or there are GPs, but it might take 6 to 8 weeks to get in to see them. So common sense has to prevail, and I'm sure that the general practitioners will work with the pharmacists to make sure, as they always have, that the partnership works.
The concern that some doctors have raised here is that they prescribe medications for a reason. Does this scheme in any way put patient safety at risk?
No, it absolutely doesn't. But look, it's been piloted or trialled in Queensland. It's working well. It will be a pilot, a trial here in New South Wales, but based on what we've seen in Canada, New Zealand and the UK, it will work well. And can I say, obviously what we're doing is expanding on the one hand the vaccination side of things. It was only 2 years ago that we had to expand to allow pharmacists to provide vaccines for COVID. They already do. They already do influenza, COVID, a range of other meningococcal, A, C, W, Y, a whole host of vaccines. But then the treatment. The treatments we're going to be doing are, again, really necessary. I mean, anybody who's ever had a UTI, and it's mostly women, would know that urinary tract infection is hellishly painful. Mm. If you have to wait a day, let alone 6 to 8 weeks, to get the antibiotic, that's just, it's actually, you can't, there's no justification for that. So the bottom line here is we will make sure it works, we'll do it safely, and of course it's under review, it's a pilot. I think the GPs, the organisations that represent them are speaking up, but I think they also need to just take a chill pill and relax and just see how it works as we go with them.
Take a chill pill.
They can prescribe.
Is that prescribed?
It themselves.
Yeah. David, for you, when they say that it's madness, what do you think they mean? What are they most concerned about losing power of here?
Look, when we're talking about health, we've got to look through the eyes and the needs of the patient. First and foremost, and, you know, if you're saying it's unsafe, well, is it safe not to get any treatment at all? Will it lead to further, you know, unintended consequences? Will it make the scenario worse? You know, if it's Saturday afternoon and you know you've got a urinary tract infection, you know that you need treatment, you've had the same treatment before, you know what fixes it quickly, will delaying it 3-4 days make it worse? And we know in, you know, 10% of people in Sydney have had to wait 3 weeks or more to see a GP. We know that rises to about close to 20% in rural areas. So this is about addressing a patient need. It's done overseas and it's evidence-based. Now, pharmacists have consulting rooms now. They can't do a vaccine without one in the pharmacy. They're safe, they're trained. They're trained 5 years degree and then further training after. And if we use COVID, for example, we did the same module as the GPs and the nurses.
Where is a pharmacist going to find the time to carve out of their day?
Oh, we're all, you know, struggling with work at the moment. The whole whether it's the builder or a baker, you know, the workforce shortages are there for everyone. But ultimately, it's for patients' needs. And you can still go to the GP if you want to. You can go and see the pharmacist if you want to. And that's what we're trying to do here. And we're addressing a need. The Australian Institute of Health and Welfare, they have a list of avoidable hospitalisations. Urinary tract infections are up there. Yep. Vaccinations, unvaccinated people are up there. And there's a whole list. And this is good news, really, for the public.
All right. How do we get one of those chill pills, Brad?
Well, probably go to the pharmacy, I think, because I'm not sure that the GPs will have them, but anyway.
Good on you. Needs one today, not in 6 weeks.
Can I just say this? Our government, the Liberal government here, Liberal National government here in New South Wales, we don't do things rashly, we do things carefully. And we have done it. We got through COVID, we did it carefully. We're doing this carefully. We will continue to work with the entire health system. I have to say, as the health minister, that I think people who go and get treatment from a pharmacy in an urgent situation, or for that matter, even not so urgent, should still go to their GP regularly to make sure that they're getting a full and holistic assessment. But that doesn't, one doesn't exclude the other, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, 100%.
That makes sense. All right, well, good on you guys. Thank you.
But first today, New South Wales pharmacists will be able to prescribe medications, including contraceptives and antibiotics, in a major shake-up to the state's health system.
General practitioner Dr. Vyom Sharma joins us now to discuss this. Vyom, good to have you on the show. Some GPs have labelled this plan a recipe for disaster. Are you one of them?
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's a huge problem here. And one of the ones that people know about is the fact that it's the doctor's job. It's what we're trained to do, which is to prescribe these medications, do the follow-up, see if it's the right treatment with an appropriate battery of tests that we can use to see if it's the right way to go. This is not something that's within the scope of pharmacists to do. But I think there's a really there's a bigger principle here that's getting ignored, which is that we've got this kind of implicit principle in Australia, which is this separation of powers of that the fact that the medications that doctors are prescribing, we don't profit directly from that. And that entire ethical framework is now under threat, which would be pharmacists, the ones who are prescribing the medications, would also be the ones directly profiting from it. As much as possible, we should try to separate those things. Something that surprises a lot of people, that's pretty much the reason why GPs aren't allowed to own pharmacies. We try to separate these vested interests out as much as possible. That's completely under threat now. Right. I think it's a recipe for disaster.
I suppose some people say, well, if I've been taking the same contraceptive for 10 years though, is there not room there for a pharmacist to at least take over the prescribing of that medication when there's so much pressure on GPs at the moment?
And I think the example of contraceptives is a really good one, because that's one where I agree we probably need to make access a bit easier. On the other hand, every year I will speak to many, many women who I actually need to change off those contraceptives, because as we age and our health behaviours change, our risk profile changes. So what may seem like a routine script for to people for many months, maybe even years, often we actually need to change based on how the rest of your health modifies, and only really GPs are getting that full picture. So there may well be a balance to be struck, but I feel we're kind of throwing the baby out with the bathwater here by just letting pharmacists prescribe full stop.
Vyom, while we've got you, I want to talk about this other medical news, and that's the COVID case numbers. They're rising again across the country. So what's your advice to people who are most at risk? And we were talking this morning about if you have, say you're on your third booster or going to your fourth booster, depending on your age, is that lessening the effects of this round of COVID?
Absolutely. So we know that these boosters, even with these new variants, are holding up. Yes, sir, these newer variants have an ability to spread a bit faster, and some of them have slightly greater ability to evade your immune system, but not completely. Certainly not if you've been vaccinated and up to date with your boosters. So if you are eligible, go out and get your booster. You'll be ensuring yourself and the rest of your family safe for this upcoming Christmas period. The other thing, if you're out and about, is carry an N95 mask with you in those environments when you're in indoor shared spaces, and you know you can put one on. I realise we can't put it on all the time, but public transport, etc., pop one on.
I mean, this is really, I suppose, upsetting for some people, because we're coming into Christmas season. It's Christmas parties, it's Christmas gatherings, it's families that have been, were apart for a long period of time. How worried are you, just quickly, about this fourth wave?
The reality is no one really knows how high it's going to peak. My only concern is that there's lots of people eligible for the booster who have not taken it. They're the only people I'm really worried about. As for everyone else, if we can just have a bit of a kind of awareness and culture of wearing masks when we can, I think we'll be okay. That plus the boosters, fingers crossed, we should be okay for this Christmas period.
All right, Dr. Vyom Sharma, we'll hold you to that. Good to see you, buddy. Take care.